You know, we're all close. We think we're close, right? When we listen to non-dual teachings and stuff, we say, "Oh yeah, I almost got it." Well, I mean, in hindsight, I've been that way my entire life. So that's a trap. It's thinking that you're close. So what you have to do is live your life in a dharmic way. That's what really gets you close. Otherwise, you just spend your whole life reading these, books of sayings and non-quotes and, Facebooking your whole life. You're not going to get there. You have to pay attention to the bigger picture, which is really just to lose interest in doubt. It's just a matter of losing interest overall. So really, you have to be aware that the orchestration of your life, the grace of God, will orchestrate your life in such a way that you will ultimately succeed. And you cannot just do it just simply by I need to somehow get it. I need to. It doesn't work like that. So, for example, last night I had this dream, and oftentimes we're given a good advice in dreams. And I woke up. I said, "Oh my gosh, there's something wrong," and I was able to figure it out. I said, "Uh-oh, okay," and God was telling me, "Hey, don't watch the surf contest. It's causing you too much nervousness," which is true, very, very true. For some reason, I get very agitated, really bad, my nerves, and this was symbolized by all this, suddenly the roof leaking all around, really, really terrible. There's water pouring in everywhere. Water's emotionless in this instance. And I realized, okay, I got to stop. That's the room where I would watch the surf contest. So I didn't watch it today. I didn't watch it. So I heeded the advice. It's a heeded advice. So God will tell us, hey, you're getting off track. Got to stop it. Same thing on Facebook. He said, he showed me in a dream. Don't keep posting kitschy stuff, meaning the pictures and quotes is kitschy stuff. Come from American term kitsch. It's gigas. I mean, it's superficial kind of. It's not helpful. He was telling me that don't do that, don't do that. Can it be helpful? Yeah, but he doesn't want me to do it, and so I stopped doing it. I stopped doing it. Stopped doing it. I stopped posting this beautiful artwork, beautiful graphics and stuff. And I had made so many beautiful ones; they're just amazing. But God says, for you right now, that's not right. It's causing you problems. So again, a dream came, and I paid heed to it, and I stopped doing it. So this is dharmic, this is dharmic. Dharmic culture is an your overall, the totality of your experiencing, allowing the grace of God to be everywhere in that totality and not just on trying to get some non-dual insight or something, okay? Totality of your life. He wants me to run. He says, and so I ran today, but my knee's hurting. I said, uh-oh. That's not good. So God, why do you want me to rub my knee? My knee hurts hurting. So we'll see how it feels in the morning, because it's been feeling really good my knee for the last several days. I've been putting a lot of strain on it. Now it's starting to hurt again. I said, wow. It's difficult to understand exactly, how to get guidance in life, isn't it? Very seemingly difficult. It's a super frustrating. Can we not all get better guidance? It's like that, and Jesus tells us that we're being told exactly what to do if we'll just listen to it. Well, yeah, but apparently we're not very good listeners. I guess you got to be a perfect listener, and who among us is a perfect listener? So things are not so easy. So make sure that you pay just as much attention to whatever you're doing. Make sure everything is dharmic. You have to have this attitude that everything in your life is dharmic. Meaning, you should be applying skillful means, skillful awareness, attention to every aspect of your life, everything. And when you do that, everything seems auspicious. So maybe my knee will get in a couple of days, will feel great. I'll be able to run some more. I hope so. This is probably just kind of pushed it and aggravated a little bit, and it'll in the long run it'll be good. I need to start running. I don't have any stride at all to speak of. It's really weird. I've forgotten how to run. So the reason why nobody in history has been able to pin down enlightenment is because enlightenment only happens when you just when you lose interest in doubt. You're just not interested anymore. And so there's no technique to it, really. Ultimately, it's just, I'm just not interested. I'm more interested in certainty. I'm much more attracted to certainty. So I'm just not interested in doubt. Because we could always generate doubt in our mind. That's what we've been doing. So there's no way we can heal the mind. There's no healing. The mind's not sick. You can't heal the mind. It's not sick. It's just generating doubt, right? Trying to generate doubt, like a game it's playing. And it can play that game whenever it wants to. The mind is free, it's perfect. So whatever's happening can always happen. So this dream of doubt, we can always have a dream of doubt if we want to. There's no way to block that. There's no way to block it. So we just have to lose interest in it. And so how can there be any exactly set equation to lose interest in it that is the same for everyone? Everyone's path will be different as far as losing interest in it. There can be practices which are greatly helpful. Okay, but the practice itself isn't the answer. It's losing interest that's the answer. And so this afternoon I was very tired and I felt like taking a nap, and I laid down, and then this idea came to me. I said, how would it be to just lose interest in thinking? Lose interest in your thoughts. Instead of trying to meditate your thoughts away, or just lose interest in them. And I said, yeah, let's just do that. I'm just not interested in thinking anymore. That's all. Just not interested. And then I went into this very, very amazing, I can't even describe it, half sleep kind of state. Very auspicious. So it's just, you just say, how would it be just to lose interest in thinking? That's all. And I said, yeah, let's just like that, just like that, just lose interest in it. So you're not applying anything to make it that way, you see. You're not trying to force yourself or accomplish some goal or anything. You just sort of, Jesus says, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. But even that suggests that you're doing something. But what he's really getting at is just how would it be to just not be interested in thinking anymore? Like that. It's so much more gentle, isn't this? This approach, so gentle, like this. And this is what I, the path I'm on is the path of, gentle glory. It's very gentle, very self-forgiving, forgiving of ourselves, and everything becomes very smoothed out and gentle. So instead of saying I have to lose interest in my thoughts, like it's something I got to do, it arose in me like, well, no, more like a suggestion, like a nice gentle suggestion, like how would it be to, just lose interest in thoughts. Does that interest you? Just losing interest in thoughts? And I said, well, yeah, why not? That sounds like I want to try that. So it's like that. Nanamayima always said that her kayal, her inner guidance would act in that way. It would say like, how would it be to do this? Or how would it be to play the role of a, this and that, kind of like. Not saying you have to do this, but how would it be to do this? You think you might be interested in this? It's very gentle sort of guidance. How would it be just to lose interest in thinking? And do you want to try that? And I said, yeah, let's try it. Just focus on the certainty within. So, reading Journey Beyond Words last night, I came to the realization that, it's the certainty behind the words. The journey beyond words only takes place when you lose interest in thinking and words, because you're attracted to the certainty beyond the words. The certainty, okay. Words are not certain in themselves at all. Okay, they're just arbitrary, actually. And so, there's no certainty in labels. How can you label certain? It's just a convention that we agree upon. Anyone can say, "Well, I want to call this." I mean, you go like on trips, vacations, and there's Lake Elizabeth, or Lake Johnson, or Wapuma Lake, or just whatever. Somebody name the lake something, and the road and the state. We're going into Kansas now. What do you mean? That's arbitrary. Somebody before it was Kansas, it was something else. The Indians called that something else. They didn't even have the boundaries back then. So someone drew some boundaries and said, "We're going to call these the land within these arbitrary boundaries. We're going to call what do you think? Let's say Kansas." Oh, okay, we'll call it Kansas. Yeah, but we tend to think that labels are actually true. Like somehow that's what it is. It's completely arbitrary. So certainty is beyond labels, beyond words. So Jesus says, journey beyond words to the certainty. So what's important is the certainty that is conveyed. That's all. That's more important than all sorts of theory, actually. Because ultimately, the only answer is just to lose interest in doubt. You can't fixate the mind in freedom. Okay, so freedom means the mind is free to imagine itself fixated. So you cannot fixate the mind so it cannot imagine itself to be fixated. That's impossible. And that's where we have trouble. We say, "No, I gotta cure myself so I never do this again," and I can't do that. Freedom is intrinsic, and so there's nothing we can do to fixate that. You cannot fixate intrinsicness. It's already that way. Any attempt to fixate it is actually doubt. It's actually doubt. So paradoxically, giving up the attempt to be free of doubt is the way to realize freedom in a paradoxical way, isn't it? You realize, well, the mind is free to doubt itself if it wants to. I mean, I can doubt myself if I want to. I can doubt my freedom if I want to. But I don't have to. I'm free to not doubt it also. And then it's just a matter of interest. What am I interested in? What do I want to do? And then we say, "Well, I'm interested in certainty now." Okay, then that's what we're going to do. That's how our experiencing is going to be. So we cannot fixate the mind on freedom. That's a redundancy. And what we're trying to do is prevent it from doubting itself again. But this cannot be done. This cannot be done. The mind is free to pretend it's not the mind, and will always be free. You cannot have a freedom that's denying the mind something. It says, "Mind, you can't do this. You cannot pretend you're not free. You cannot have a freedom like that. That's not absolute freedom. The mind is absolutely free to pretend it's not free. Right? That's part of absolute freedom. So we have to accept that fact." But if we don't get this, we will always view enlightenment as some great leap, some drastic step, it's not like that. Peace of God is really what they say, enlightenment, peace of God, viewing everything as consciousness, peace of God, is the same, is guru vision. It dawns with imperceptible gentleness. Because it's just a question of interest. So nothing is really causing it. So it's not like a causative event. It's imperceptible, an imperceptible dawning, actually. And as long as you're looking for some causative agent other than just losing interest and doubt, the search continues. And you will feel it's not quite right. Something isn't quite right. And you need to smooth it out. You go back to evaluation, evaluate the mind, evaluating itself. So all of this is continuing to clarify, and it's worth you know, paying attention to this. I'm certainly paying attention to this. This is where my attention is at. And it's worth noting it and saying, hey, that's interesting. Wow. Now, wow is really when the mind stops evaluating its progress towards fixating freedom, you might even say, fixating itself, even fixating freedom, the mind is gentle glory dawns. Peace of God dawns upon the mind. And then what the mind does is then it evaluates the non-evaluation. Peace of God, the mind stops evaluating its progress towards fixation. It's just not interested anymore in that. So what happens then, the mind then it evaluates its non-evaluation. It says, oh my gosh, I'm not evaluating anymore. That's great. So let me evaluate how I'm doing with my non-evaluation. And then you lose the peace of God. Very simple. So the wow practice is what we do here is used here to jump in and say, okay, I'm going to have one evaluation of my non-evaluating, which is wow. So I already have the evaluation. So when the mind starts going back to evaluating its non-evaluation, like, wow, that's a really great state I'm in. I'm not evaluating anything. Man, I got to really evaluate that. You know, this is what happens, right? Exactly what happens. You block that. You jump in and say, no, wow, I already have the evaluation, mind. Thank you very much. It's wow. I know exactly how to evaluate non-evaluation. It's wow. That's it. And then just absolutely insist, it's wow, 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 like that. And so then this quickly settles down the evaluation of non-evaluation. And it greatly lessens all that trouble the mind would get into. And so it greatly speeds up your path. It greatly speeds up the whole path towards non-interest and doubt. It greatly speeds it up and smooths it out. So you really have to jump in at the right moment when you feel yourself sliding back into evaluation. And of course, you think it's legit because you say, no, I'm just evaluating non-evaluation. No, that's the trap. Right there, that's the trap. And it's very difficult for us to not evaluate it, right? We're so addicted to evaluating our mind evaluating itself, its progress towards fixation, that we cannot, that's why we don't stay in abidance, as we go slip back into evaluating our abidance. I need to evaluate my abidance. But abidance is non-evaluation. What does freedom have to evaluate? Freedom doesn't need to evaluate itself. But we're so used to evaluating, we can't stay in abidance. So we have to limit that tendency by saying, I already have the evaluation. Don't worry, I already have it here. It's wow. I know what it is. It's wow. That's it. And you say, oh, okay, yeah, I've got it. And then you kind of relax your evaluation from that standpoint. You say, well, I've already done the evaluation. It's done. So I don't have to even work on it now. So what a great practice this is, isn't it? It's really critical to really, you know, cut down on all the struggle and delay that we experience, is to say, I've already got it, the evaluation. So yeah, so don't fight against the evaluation. As you start evaluating your non-evaluation, then you start struggling. Say, wait a minute, I'm not supposed to do that. Wait a minute, I'm supposed to do that. I'm starting to do that again. Oh no, wait a minute, how can I stop that? And you know the torment, and immediately you feel tormented in your mind again, right? Immediately you say, oh my gosh, here comes that torment again. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, no, no, no. And they say, no, no, no. I thought I was liberated and it's coming. The torment is coming back. You see, with this practice, that doesn't happen. As soon as we feel ourselves, that urge to evaluate, it's starting to come. You realize, okay, here it comes. I say, great. Yeah, great. I will evaluate this. And in fact, I already have evaluated, and I've evaluated as wow. Okay. And in fact, I evaluate all non-evaluation as wow. And I've already done with all the past and the future and everything. It's already done. It's wow is my evaluation of non-evaluation. That's it. I already have the answer. And it's a positive thing. So you never go negative. You say, that's great. I know how to evaluate. I evaluate it as wow. And then something within you says, yeah, 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 that's good. This is helpful. And you don't go into the torment. You do not go into this mental torment. It says, oh my gosh, I lost it. How did I lose it? I'm an idiot. How do I get it back? And you start panicking, right? Doesn't happen with this practice. That doesn't happen at all. You just say, I've got the answer. I've got the evaluation. And then for a while, you evaluate it as wow. And after a while, the shock wears off of the breakthrough you've had into non-evaluation. When the shock wears off, you don't feel like evaluating it so much anymore. And then you just kind of say, okay, I don't really feel like I need to evaluate anymore. I've got the wow, that's it. And it calms you down. You stay calm. You stay calm. You stay smooth. And the momentum continues, just like that. So this is very dharmic. Dharmic means skillful means of mental understanding the mind to the extent that you are able to employ skillful means in helping you towards non-evaluation, towards freedom. To get free of evaluating your freedom. Okay? Really, we're trying to fixate our freedom. As a roundabout way of actually trying to fixate hallucination, actually, which we can't do, because that would mean we're not free, right? If we have to keep hallucinating something, how free is that? What is that? The mind is free to stop hallucinating any moment, any instant. The mind is free to shift its experiencing any instant. It doesn't have to evaluate what it's experiencing. Because it's free every instant spontaneously to experience something else. So evaluation, you could say, is instantaneous. It's all spontaneous. There's no what we would say evaluating or fixation. Okay, there's no fixation of evaluation. You could say the mind is aware of what it's, and says it might choose something else, but it's a flow, instantaneous flow that we cannot imagine in our minds in terms of evaluating it. It cannot be evaluated. We cannot evaluate the mind, the freedom of the mind. It cannot be evaluated. Okay, but again, we have this massive, massive familiarity and habit of evaluation, trying to evaluate the mind. Habit, it will always spring back on us until we're finally free of it. But until then, we have to just be honest with ourselves and say, here it comes again. So let me just jump in. I've got it. Yeah, you want evaluation? Here it is. It's like a kid starts to cry, and you hand the kid the, you know, these days, a tablet or something, or smartphones. Oh, here you go, play games on it. Oh, the kid calms down immediately, right? So, oh, I got my game back. It used to be toys, you know, whatever toys. It, kid gets cranky. Come on. Oh, here goes your toy. Oh, quiet. Like that. And then you take the toy away again at some point, and the kid's all right for a while, and it starts getting cranky again. Want my toy? Okay, here's your toy. Just give the kid the toy. So give ourselves the evaluation. When we start heading towards evaluating our non-evaluation, give yourself the evaluation of wow. You know, it's so obvious that you'll kick yourself once you realize this and start using it. You say, oh my gosh, this works. It's like a miracle.
Yeah.
It's like, well, why is it giving a toy to a kid work? You know, because he's interested in it. You know, what could you say? And so giving ourselves this answer to our evaluation, say, yeah, I have the evaluation right here. We don't have to go through any process of evaluation at all. We already have it. So instantly we have it, and then we say, oh, yeah, that's right. Non-evaluation is wow. I got the evaluation. So you feel like, yeah, I got the evaluation right here. There's no panic sets in, no panic. The panic sets in when we feel we're not able to evaluate non-evaluation, then we start struggling in every direction, and it gets worse and worse and worse. And before you know, we're in this panic mental state, and then we try to fixate on some process or something, and say, well, I need this process of evaluation. I got to find it. And then we're in this desperate search again, right? And some come up with some religion, some this and some that, of philosophy or something. This is the evaluation. And then we're lost. We're lost. This way, with the wow, we already have the evaluation. We don't get lost anywhere. We stay real close to peace of God. Real close. It's real close with me. I can feel it's very close. It's so close. Just right ready to just, you know, it's just imperceptibly dawn. But I have to be aware of, okay, so the evaluation of this is wow, and I'll just keep that for now. And I believe it can be induced in certain ways when you determine, say, I'm going to evaluate my freedom as wow, okay? I'm going to evaluate it as wow. Every time my mind goes back to evaluation, I already have it as wow. Then what happens is you will become more courageous in stepping into non-evaluation, or allowing the imperceptibly gentle dawning of the peace of God, non-evaluation, to dawn upon you. You'll be much more willing because you won't panic. You say, no, I know exactly when I want to evaluate, exactly how I'll evaluate this. I've already predetermined my evaluation of the peace of God, which is wow. So you have a predetermined evaluation already present in your mind, and you just have to keep reminding yourself that you've got this. And so then you're willing to, you know, allow the peace of God to dawn upon you with imperceptible gentleness. Imperceptible gentleness means you can't even see it to evaluate it. You can't even see it to evaluate it. And that's the experience that I've had, is I said, well, how do I evaluate this? You know, I mean, it's the same everywhere. It's imperceptibly the same. Yeah, it's very important to bring this concept, or at least whatever you want to call it, imperceptibly the same. I've never heard of this like that, but I find this. The Holy Spirit said, why don't you look at it this way? I said, wow, that's super helpful. When I was in the peace of God, he said, you know, this is like, feels like imperceptibly the same. So there's nothing to evaluate. But I'm going to evaluate it as wow. Let me just say wow like this. And so it was very... when I gradually, it just gradually kind of faded away. But there was no torment in me, you know? I didn't panic or torment or anything. I just paid attention, said, okay, and let me get more clear about this. And I have. So this is a very fruitful way, right? Very fruitful way. Wow is a very fruitful way. The wow way is very, very fruitful. Very, very wise. And it's the result of a lifetime of you know, hard knocks, a lifetime of mental torment, as I kept losing clarity, you know, and then struggling to get it back. And just for decades and decades and decades, it just, you know, horrible struggles and ragged, the past so ragged, up and down, this and that. And I said, I've got to smooth this out or I'm going to fail. You know, it's just, I can't spend a whole lifetime with it being so tumultuous and tormented, being tormented by ups and downs. So I was determined to find some way to smooth it out. And so gradually, just by observing myself with great patience and determination, observing the mind, I began to find some way to not react to the success and the fail, you know, smooth it out. And ultimately, this come to this clarity about using the wow as the ultimate evaluation. And the key is to not allow any other evaluation to enter your mind. Because immediately then, there's a conflict then of, well, great, I have two labels here. Now, which one is better? And that'll drive you crazy, won't it? I mean, there's nothing that could drive you. That's the root of craziness, is which label, you know, which label, which evaluation label is better? And, of course, there is no answer to that ultimately, is there? So you have to arbitrarily decide on just one label. One label. Now, I say arbitrarily, but wow is so abstract that it seems it's a beautiful label. Okay, let's put it that way. It's a beautiful label. And so you cannot try to have two labels. Okay, this is the thing. You must just have one. That's why Christians think that Jesus said that there's only one way. What Jesus was saying, the right practice is to use just one label, one evaluation, one label for your evaluation, and none other. Just hang just to that. And this has ultimately been distorted into thinking that, you know, Jesus Christ, the appearance of Jesus, somehow he, you know, his sacrifice on the cross is the only way and stuff like that. They've distorted it all. It's really Jesus. Jesus said his teachings and practices he's giving out, because his teachings are really practices for us. He says, That is the way, that is my body. That is my treasure I'm giving you. He said the flesh profiteth nothing. It's his teachings that are important. And that got distorted into thinking his body was important. But his teachings were this sovereign way of one evaluation of the peace of God. Not two, just one. And then there's no conflict in our minds about evaluating what label we're going to use for non-evaluation. Evaluating our evaluation of non-evaluation. You see, it's an endless progression, isn't it? And you can feel the mind, you know, how it unravels, right? How your peace unravels this way if you do that. But if you just say, no, I'm just, wow is my evaluation and that's it. And the more you practice just this one evaluation is it, the more success you will have. There's no doubt about that. It's the key. It really is the key. So this has been taught throughout history, actually. I'm just re-clarifying this with the talents I've had from previous lifetimes of being a composer, a musical composer, like symphonies and complex musical works, is I would work over and over and over and over and over, so it was extremely clear musically, you know, what I wanted it to sound like. So it's just my karma to be willing to do this with the wow practice, because this practice has been around from time immemorial, actually. All the wise ones have known this, okay. But it keeps slipping through our grasp, right? So it needs to be reintroduced again and again and again and again, and it will have to be reintroduced just, and so I've been willing to do this, work on it. It's just sort of my natural habits. Work on something for a long, 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 long time without. I'd work on a symphony for 10, 15 years before it was even presented to the public. So I'm able to defer gratification or whatever you want to call it for a long time while I just keep working to make it clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer. So this is how my life has been. I've been working on this for a long time. And, you know, it still hasn't really caught on yet in the world. But I'm still working on it to make it, you know, clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer, because this is the sovereign way. It's the way that really works. It's the way Jesus really, the teachings he gave out to his closest disciples is just this. Just one way, not two. Okay? That's what it means. Just one evaluation, just one way of evaluating non-evaluation, and not two ways of evaluating non-evaluation. As soon as you bring a second way in, conflict, your mind, your peace will unravel. Your conflict will, and torment will come to your mind. So which evaluation is better? Maybe this one, I like this one a little better, and this way, the other one, not so much. But why, you know, how can I decide on which one is better? You know, immediately you're in trouble. So you have to just make a effort of will to say, look, wow is it. Wow is it. And again, throughout history, someone might say, you know, something else is it. But it's the same practice. So what are we fighting over? It's ridiculous. Argumentation about this is ridiculous, because it's ultimately, labels are arbitrary. And so you might say, Om is it. You know, just Om is my evaluation of non-evaluation. Right? Om. Right? Okay. Same practice. Same practice. As long as you hold just to that, then everything will be fine. It's the same practice. That has a nice abstractness to it too. Om, right? I would advise using something that's quite abstract, but that not that's capricious or absurdist. You know, it has no connection. Wow has a direct connection to how we feel, because we express ourselves, at least in English language. And a lot of people around the world, it's like, you know, wow, that's amazing. Like, Tibetans use imaho, for instance. Imaho, wow, that's so amazing. Imaho kind of means, wow, how marvelous, you know, like that. How marvelous the peace of God is. So that, you know, some Tibetans might use imaho as a practice. That's it, just imaho, you know. How marvelous is non-evaluation? So that's their one evaluation of non-evaluation. But you have to stick with just one. And this has been tested out and tested out and tested out. And you know, you obviously, you know what I'm talking about if you really practice. How soon as you go into comparativeness with evaluations, the whole stability is gone. You start feeling sinking into quicksand. It's really like quicksand. You start sinking into mental quicksand. The more you struggle, the more you go into that quicksand. And it's horrible, isn't it? And of course, I've lived a lifetime like this. Of here I go again, I stepped into the quicksand, and he just says dread overtakes you, like, oh my gosh, if I don't struggle, I'm stuck, but if I do struggle, I get even more stuck, and what do I do? And then you start say, maybe I can struggle in a clever way, and oh no, I'm starting, and you feel like you're sinking down into quicksand, and that you're going to be engulfed by it, right? It's dreadful anxiety. Whereas if you insist it's just wow and block all other evaluation, guess what? There's no feeling that you're sinking into quicksand at all. In fact, I feel fine. I feel stable, and there's no worries. My mind is calm. My nerves are shaking, just like wow, right? Because that was, I did it. You know, I mean, I got to non-evaluation, and my evaluation of that is wow. End of story. End of story. So you keep it super simple. Kiss it. Keep it super simple. Okay, that's a nice mnemonic device. If you forget, you say, kiss. I know. I want to be kissed by what? Oh, keep it super simple. Let me kiss this. Let me give this a kiss. Keep it super simple. Oh, yeah. Just one evaluation of non-evaluation. Wow. And immediately, you're able to remind yourself of this. Keep it super simple. Keep it super simple. Oh, yeah, super simple means one evaluation. What's my one evaluation? Wow. Oh, yeah. I'm just going to do just that. The trouble is when we get arrogant and greedy and say, no, I don't want to evaluate at all, so I'm going to try and not evaluate it. And so I'm going to reject wow, and then another thought arrives. How about this evaluation? I'm going to reject that. Reject that. And then you get into the struggle of rejecting all these evaluations. But that itself is a suffering. You're evaluating your evaluations to try to get rid of them. so to speak. I you know, one way is to just, whatever thought arises, say, no, that's not it. No, that's not it. No, that's not it. But that's one way, okay. What I found is that's too much of a struggle and effort right there. And that's a bit of a torment and fearful, actually. Like, what happens if my evaluation does come back on me? And it always does, doesn't it? So instead of doing it that way, just admit, be humble. Say, yeah, of course I'm going to evaluate this. That's been my habit for eons and eons and eons. And I'm too frightened to just drop all evaluation forever. I just went through a period for a while where I dropped it. Now it's starting to creep back on me. So instead of trying to meditate away all evaluations, just say, no, I have one evaluation, and it's wow, and I'm okay with that for right now. And then don't need any struggle at all, any struggle at all. So it's the humble path, isn't it? Instead of saying, you know, I've got the peace of God, and I'm going to make sure I don't evaluate in any way, and I'm going to fight like crazy to prevent any evaluation. You're just struggling with massive familiarity and habit, which is foolish. You're going to lose. You're going to lose, and you know, you're going to lose 1,000 times and 1,000 times more. And you set up a battle within yourself, like you're fighting against yourself. Instead, honor your creativity. Be kind to yourself, compassionate to yourself, and say, you know what? I've been super, super creative in trying to fixate, trying to evaluate freedom, fixate the mind. Super, super, duper creative. So there's no way in the world that I'm just going to be able to just break out of that and free myself from that, so to speak. That's ridiculous. And I don't even want to, because I want to honor my creativity. My gosh. The everything we've done, this universe is you know, very creative, right? Attempt to fixate the mind is very creative, and even some of it is you know, somewhat beautiful, and we love our creativity, so we are not going to. We have to take the compassionate, loving approach of saying, I'm not quite ready yet to drop all evaluation of what I've done. But let me just choose one evaluation for it, and that's sort of a compromise. It's compassionate, right? It's honoring myself, my creativity, honoring the mind and its creativity. And when you try this, you'll feel way better about yourself, way, way better, no struggle. And there's something within you that says, ah, I love myself. And then you're way more likely to accept the peace of God then for yourself, because you realize, you know what? I'm a very fair mind. I'm a fair-minded person. I feel that there's something really wonderful within me to be this wise and fair to myself. And so you'll have this sort of rapport with yourself. There'll be this inner rapport. And you won't feel the path is like some adversarial. You won't feel an adversarial relationship within you. So this is all the work of great hindsight and great effort to be this clear about it. And I obviously can see that others are not this clear about it, which is tough, because I'd like to be able to pass this on and save everybody, you know, immense mental torment, which, if you don't know this technique, that's what you're going to experience, is immense mental torment. Or you'll stall out and say, well, maybe I can't quite make it this life. Let's eat, drink, and be merry, you know, a little bit here. And you lower the bar, you start lowering the bar. One of the two. And for me, lowering the bar was not an option, because I've had it. You know, I realized that I don't want to return to this place, in no way. I don't have any choice, actually. I have no choice. This is my last life. I've seen that if mind cannot be fixated, we cannot stabilize insecurity of hallucination. It's impossible. So I said that then there's no reason to come back to this world at all. I could see it. There's no reason at all. It's completely futile. So from that standpoint, then I had to get the answer. I could not lower the bar. So that would never work for me. So I got the answer of the wow practice, the wow evaluate, the one evaluation. So I had to get it. And I can see, you know, but getting it, the torment was, you know, tremendous, tremendous torment. And I know that if we don't get this practice, just one evaluation practice, the torment will continue, and ultimately we'll stall out and say, well, I just have to come back here again. I don't know. I didn't quite get it. I didn't get the right evaluation. It's not about the right evaluation. It's about using the technique of one evaluation. Evaluations are meaningless. So you can't, there's no such thing as a right evaluation, because all evaluations are meaningless. Evaluating freedom is completely meaningless. So you just have to arbitrarily or wisely let the Holy Spirit choose for you, which is what I did. The Holy Spirit says, "What? How would you think about just using wow as an evaluation?" And I said, wow, I like that. Immediately I liked it. Right off the bat I said, yeah, wow, I like wow as an evaluation. It feels really, really good. So it was just suggested to me by the grace of God, why don't you try this? And I said, okay, yeah, I'll try this. And once you, it's arbitrary, of course, there is no valuation of freedom, but by accepting this willfully, your will says, okay, this is a convention, a skillful means, that's Dharmic's convention of skillful means, this really works. Pragmatic. So it has to happen with all of us, that we smooth out our path and get free of the torment and get this inner rapport going. So someday someone will ask me, how did you do this? How did the peace of God's upon you? Wow, that's amazing. How did you do this? Well, this is exactly how I did it. I'm saying right now how it's done. Just one evaluation. And again, let the Holy Spirit suggest to you what to use. And Rama Maharshi said, many will use the wow. It's very, you know, if it's, for me, it's like, yeah, I like it. Because it really fits how I feel. Like, wow. Amazing. How marvelous the grace of God is. It's kind of means like, how marvelous the grace of God is. You know, wow. How marvelous that I'm able to, I feel I'm going to succeed. How marvelous I can only, this making one evaluation is so helpful. How marvelous it is. So wow, just, you know, conveys this just feeling of 360 degree, as very abstract acceptance, kind of sort of a total acceptance. And also incorporates the shock of acceptance. Like, wow, I'm kind of shocked. I'm elated, but I'm also shocked. It conveys this feeling of mutual elation and shock. But again, we won't spend any time arguing with anybody over this. If they want to use something else, then they use something else. The principle is exactly the same. But here, I'm going to speak and use wow. Because as soon as we try to bring in some other term, then the whole situation becomes conflicted about which term do we use. And, you know, it's like that. So in order to illustrate the principle, I have to be very, you know, consistent with this. Otherwise, people get confused and say, wait a minute. So I need to evaluate. Should it be wow, or should it be maho, or should it be this or this? Maybe I'm not sure this one today, but I don't know why I feel today. Torment. But if you have to immediately be committed to it. It's commitment. I'm committed to the wow. I'm not committed to anything else. So there's no question in my mind. I'm totally committed. So commitment is essential. Whatever term the Holy Spirit suggests to you, commitment is essential. You must be committed to that term. And we're going to use the mother term of wow for this teaching. You know, however it plays out in anyone's life, they can say, well, yeah, I got this from the wow practice. You need to delineate it so people are not confused. There needs to be some, right, some delineation to help us. But we've clarified that this is a practice. It's not a person that's the way. It's the practice that is the way. That's what Jesus was telling us. It's not me. It's not the body. Not the appearance. Jesus is the way. It's this practicing. It's the teaching I'm bringing you that's the way. And you need to practice like this. Okay, so we really missed the point of it. They didn't use, they used to get it back in history. There's a lot of Christians that were liberated, okay? A lot. Into the peace of God. Absolutely there was. They knew the practice, right practice. But through thousands of years, it's gotten really, really to the point where I don't know how many Christians there are left in the world that even know this practice anymore. There might be a few. And it's like some, secret, like, there's some secret practice. There shouldn't be secret practice. What do you mean? And the whole purpose of Christianity is to spread this practice to all those who hear it. Everybody should know this practice. How could we not know this practice? This is the heart of Christianity. It's the heart of all religions, actually, is this practice. It's the heart and soul of all religions. But it gets lost, doesn't it, in rituals and all this kind of stuff. And, the priests say, well, we'll do it for you. Now you have to do it for yourself. You have to practice. The Eucharist just simple ritualizes it, actually, and they've mixed a whole bunch of stuff else into it, but it's just this one simple evaluation and nothing else, right? And so they're telling you, just do just this. That's all you need to do. Just this one practice is all you need to do, which is true. The WOW practice is the only practice anyone needs to do, actually. It's the only practice anyone needs to do. It will absolutely work into allowing the peace of God for the abidance to be continuous, but not fixated. We can't fixate ourselves in freedom. As soon as we try to fixate ourselves, we're not free anymore, are we? So what is it that needs to be fixated in freedom? No, we are freedom. We're not something within freedom. We are freedom. But for a while, it will feel like there's something abiding in freedom, okay? But we just have to get used to that. We understand. And just, wow. Anytime we start getting pulled out of that, just say, okay, my evaluation of my abidance is wow. There's nothing else to say about it at all. Because, of course, some clever people say, well, who is it that's abiding? They'll say that. Well, it's nonsense. They don't understand their grandstanding when they say that. Who is it that's abiding? Well, who is it that's asking that question, actually? Right? They're trying to trick you into evaluation. By trying to drive you free of evaluation, they're really going to pull you out of abidance, which is, they're stupid if they do that. You don't say who is it that's abiding, because that completely lacks compassion and understanding of the terrible habits that the role that familiarity plays in all this. We're still in a fragile mental condition. Even in abidance, we still are. You should never say who is it that's abiding. That's a no-no. Really, it is. That's one-upsmanship. That's spiritual one-upsmanship. So we preclude that. We don't ask questions like that. Who is it that's abiding? Who is it that's abiding in freedom? we will say, wow is abiding in freedom. Okay, because we're trying to say, who is it? That's an evaluation, right? So we say, well, wow is abiding in freedom. Well, who is wow? Wow is wow. So we have a way to block this spiritual one-upsmanship that's, Neo-Advaita. There's a lot of different stuff in the world that some of it's legit, but the stuff that's not legit uses that stuff to, mess with your mind, right, to make themselves feel better. They're not in abidance. They don't feel in abidance, so they don't want you in it either. So they say, well, who is abiding? And we'll say, wow is abiding. I said, well, who knows that wow is abiding? Wow knows that wow is abiding. Well, what is wow? Well, wow is wow. Where did wow come from? It came from wow. And so you're able to block this clever tactic that some use in the world. Okay, you're able to block it. Okay, do you hear this? Very important. Because that stuff's always been a very troublesome for me and for the mind. Those who want to get a big following, like they claim they're gurus and they want a huge following of whoever, gullible people, whatever, they just one up them like this, as if they have the answer. And they will say, well, who, you know, if you say, well, I got the peace of God, well, they say, well, who is it that has the peace of God? And they say, well, WoW has the peace of God. So this way, if we say, well, I have it, they say, well, who's I? I don't know. I said, well, so you don't know that you're an abiding. So well, who is abiding? You know, ask yourself, who is abiding? Who is abiding? This is just mental torment. They're just getting you into a state of mental torment. And then you transfer your panic onto them and say they're the savior, you know, the father, mother figure who can help you with your mental torment again. And then you get into a codependent relationship with this, you know, guru, male or female guru. And, you know, that's hell. That's hell. So here we have the answer to that. None of this nonsense, all this neo-Advaitin guru-ish stuff of who, you know, who grandstanding. It's all you know, not just neo-Advaitin stuff. Again, some neo-Advaitin teachers may be very legitimate, but you have to recognize here that we have all the answers. Okay, so we don't. There's no question at all for us. WoW is abiding. Okay, that's it. How long has it been abiding? Well, how long has WoW been abiding? WoW has been WoW long abiding. And how did WoW get there? WoW got there by WoW. And where did WoW come from? WoW came from WoW. Where is it going? It's going to WoW. What is it like to be without WoW? It's WoW to be without WoW. Now that you just continue to stick to one evaluation, you refuse to get pulled in to their games, okay? Very nasty mind games that can be played like this. It stalls us all out. So this is the end of their, you know, their little... It's really psychotic what they're doing. It's the end of that. We're shrinking their field of play by bringing this information out. And they might say, well, you're psychotic. You're just saying wow all the time. You must be crazy. I said, wow is wow. I said, no, you're crazy. I say wow is wow. Crazy as wow. Wow as wow. It's all wow. I said, well, you're insane. Wow as wow. They'll try to get you off of that singular evaluation, okay? Which then really is you start going into spiraling into an abyss like of quicksand, right? And then they're the ones that you cling to protect you from sinking into the quicksand, right? And then you end up, you know how it goes. Not good at all. They demand more and 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 more from you. To you say, oh, I'm getting tired of keeping you out of the quicksand. Oh, you know, and I think I need to let go of you. No, 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 no. What do you need? You know, well, I need this and this and this and this and this and this. Okay, guru, okay. You become a slave. You become a slave to them like that. And they know they're sociopaths, actually. Everyone in this world is psychotic, and you can use that term, but not everyone is sociopathic, okay? But there are sociopaths who exploit psychosis for their own, you know, power and aggrandizement sort of thing, to try and stabilize their own insecurity. And there are these sociopaths, and they you know, are problematic, to say the least. So we have the cure for sociopaths now, okay? We have it. But you have to protect yourself from that. So practice this. Who's abiding in the peace of God? WoW is. Who's experiencing it? WoW is. What is WoW? WoW is WoW. Where did WoW come from? WoW came from WoW. What's the origin of WoW? WoW is the origin of WoW. So I'll work on this. I mean, this is just coming up. Somebody help me. You may be amazed at how helpful everyone is to me. So I don't get, I try not to get mad at anyone. Some, I'm having a little dialogue with somebody, you know, over something, and, you know, they're kind of pushing me and stuff, and I'm, but I say, you know, why is this happening? Well, something's trying to get my attention. And I responded to him. He's talking about how the world's run by sociopaths and everything. And I said, well, you're right. You know, you're right. Kind of right. In psychotics, you can exploit them by being, if you're a sociopath. And the sociopaths are usually the ones who are very powerful in the world, politically, you know, and economic. I mean, they have, you know, the Illuminati, you might say, are like sociopaths. Because they've learned how to, you know, parasites. They're like parasites on psychosis. Learned how to be successfully parasitical on psychosis. And so, yeah, that's problematical. But I said, look, if you really get the confidence of spiritual practice, you're above all those sociopaths. They can't touch you. And this is true. So you do this wow practice like this, you can block that. You can block sociopaths. Because they'll press you into trying to continuously, you know, get off the one evaluation, right? Because they know that protects you from them. It does. They say, well, how did you, you know, I mean, how did you get this? Well, I got it from WoW. How'd you learn this? Well, I learned it from WoW. Well, I mean, what steps did you take? I took WoW steps. How many WoW steps did you take? I took WoW many steps. They want you to analyze. They want you to get into your analytical mind. And you stay in your abstract mind. Okay? So, very auspicious. This is really, I mean, we're in auspicious times right now. Very auspicious. It's, and we just have to keep it going like this. I'm not, see, I don't worry anymore about the world, actually, and the, all the sociopaths and, you know, this and this and that. I wow it. My reaction to it is wow. You know, all this stuff like, I hate this. No, I just wow this. I wow this. So I just have one evaluation for everything. And practice this more and more and more and more and settle on it. And you will be amazed. You will realize that you are becoming very advanced, dharmically advanced, and you'll realize you're a dharmic citizen, really. You really are. You're part of dharmic culture. When you practice this way, you are now part of dharmic culture, and you're adding to it. You know, it's a great feeling to add to dharmic culture. It really is. You will feel valuable. Like, wow. You will feel wowable. You'll feel wow is what you will feel. But, you know, it's to use a, to, just to, for the sake of talking, the sense of value, like I'm doing the right thing here. You know, this is really helpful for everyone. And so you feel worthwhile. You know, you feel value and worthwhile. And that your life is meaningful. You really feel this way. Finally, my life is what I want it to be like. Like, I wanted to help the world, and now I am doing so. This is how you will feel. And then people, then again, the sociopaths cannot jerk you around so easily. They really cannot. They might try, and they might just feel, you know, like, you know what? I'm going to leave. Like, parasite will try to bore into you, and they can't. They'll leave then. They say, I'll go bore into somebody. I'm getting hungry. I got to bore into somebody else. I need my ego fix. I need to bore into somebody that's easier. This, I'm not getting anywhere here. they feel that somehow. I had an experience like that recently, and I said, this is interesting. sort of a parasitical mind tried to bore into me, and they thought, and it just, I just seemed like they couldn't bore into me, really. And they said, "Well, I gotta go." I just didn't react. They tried to get me to react to this, this, and this, and this, dropping little reaction things, little hints like, "Hey, maybe you could react to this." Like, "Hey, maybe you could react to this." And I just kind of, it's like, you know, react. Wow, yeah, my reaction. Sure, I'll react. Wow, where's my reaction? Wow's my reaction. So they wanted to get you into hope and fear, right? Get into that quicksand of hope and fear. And you just say, "My reaction? Wow. Yeah, wow. You did this? Oh, wow. Uh-huh, wow. Oh, yeah, wow." Now, you could feel that if you're talking to a sociopath, or if you're talking to someone who's just merely psychotic but honest and wants to get better, then you feel your conversation can flow greater depth. But if a sociopathic situation, you just stay wow, just keep it like wow, yeah, all right, wow, great to see you, wow, okay. So how was that meeting? Well, it was wow. And you have to stay in your practice. How do I feel? Wow. What was that like? It was like wow. What happened? Wow happened. What kind of interchange you had? It was wow is what happened. What did you learn from it? I learned wow from it. Wow is what I learned. And you will find your nerves settle down more and more. And you become kryptonite to the sociopaths, right? So, yeah. Which is what we need here, right? We need more that are kryptonite to that type. And eventually they just say, "You know, I don't like this world so much. I think I'll go somewhere else. Kind of ran out of foraging area here. And picked all the fruit and picked all the low-hanging fruit, and there isn't any, you can't get that stuff up higher, and, you know, let's go somewhere else." Or something like that, right? Or they might say, "You know what, we don't really want you here anymore, so why don't you go to better some other place?" We'll say, "Oh, okay, we'll go to a better place." One of the two, right? We part ways. But, you know, you better do it now. I mean, someone told me just today, this super wealthy guy, man, super wealthy. I mean, he's just got the life, okay? He has the American dream life. He's also got leukemia. And he has to have his blood replaced every 3 weeks. Total transfusion every... My grandmother had this. And so I'd bring her to the hospital. I know what the hell she went through. Finally, she said, you know what? I can't take it anymore. I just can't take all these needles and tubes and going through this ordeal, you know, over and over and over again. I just, that's enough. So he has the American dream, and yet every 3 weeks he has to get this complete, you know, transfusion. That's not very dreamy, is it? No, it's not very fun at all. You know, how long can he continue to enjoy this is the question. Wow. Right, wow. So my reaction to that was wow. So you'll notice that we tend to slip. See, the problem is these sociopaths have brainwashed the world through the media and the entertainment industry and the educational industry, and to be vulnerable to them, to be reactive. So we're used to, when we talk with another, we bring up bad stuff, you know. Because, like, we're supposed to, like, say, "Well, you're supposed to be reactive. I'm supposed to react because we're being good citizens. That's what we're supposed to be," you know. No, the parasites have conditioned us to be this way. So try as you might, conversation usually starts bringing up some bad stuff, right? Like, "Oh, yeah, it's awful. Someone's really sick and someone died." And, you know, so you just have to just wow it. Say, "Oh, yeah, someone's really sick. Oh, wow. Someone got in an accident. Oh, wow. Wow. Yeah. This is, you know." So you don't expect conversations to be, you know, sattvic and beautiful about how wonderful your spiritual path. It almost never happens, at least in the Western culture. It never happens. It never happens. So you have to use this wow technique in all conversations. Just assume whoever you meet is going to throw this sociopathically conditioned negativity, try to get you to start reacting out of your wow. Like, oh, someone that's really sick. So, oh my God, that's terrible. You know, I wonder how. I hope they feel better. I hope this. You just no. See, then you're lost. You just say, oh, they're really sick. Oh, wow. Someone's had this trouble. Wow. You're not saying you're happy, you're sad, or this is terrible. Whatever. You're just saying wow. So you're staying with your single evaluation. So you must, in conversation, stay with your single evaluation. Okay. Otherwise, you get crashed because the negativity on the news, you know, people are in movies is so hideous, and music now, right? This is by design. What this my friend was saying about the world, what I've been saying is true. By design, we're being turned into hosts for parasites. To think that we can't survive without these sociopathic parasites. By design, they have enculturated the world this way. Through movies and television and music now. I mean, music is just so, you know, depraved, isn't it? So depraved. Everything is so depraved here by design. So, but we're not stupid. That doesn't mean we're going to fail. We're going to say, well, everything is so what? Well, it's so wow. It's so wow. So don't let anybody pull you into a reaction about this depravity. In fact, you just say, oh yeah, the world's really depraved. Yeah, wow. Well, are you upset about it? Well, I feel, you know, it's really, wow, this is my how I feel about it, actually. And they want to get those hope and fear going. The quicksand of hope and fear. The Buddhists call it the ocean of samsara, which is really the quicksand of hope and fear. As you struggle with labels, you struggle with evaluation. Which is insecurity. It's inherently insecure. Evaluation's inherently insecure. But if you just accept one evaluation and insist on it, yeah, where's the struggle? It really short circuits the struggle, doesn't it? It's no struggle. I know what my evaluation is. But how could you know? I don't know. Wow. Knows wow. How does it know? It knows it by wow. All right? Wow knows wow by wow. So everything keeps self-referencing to that just one evaluation. And they'll say, huh? Well, the sociopaths, they would say you're crazy. Yeah, well, that's because they're sociopathic. They want us to be crazy, so we form the symbiotic, you know, dependency relationship with them. So this is actually wowish is what it is. It's neither crazy nor not crazy. It's what is wow is what it is. It's just wow. So they say, well, are you crazy? I'm wow. You say, you're not saying you're not crazy? I'm saying I'm wow. Well, what is wow? Wow is wow. This is great practice. You know, super, super duper practice. I'm enjoying it. This is the first time I've really practiced in this way intentionally like this. So, you know, progress. The knee, it's feeling, it hurts and it's unstable. Too much pounding from the running. Gosh. You know, I was feeling great with the golf swing. I don't know why I need to run. Maybe I can just walk. I think I'm going to have to start walking, actually. But I don't like walking because around here, everybody's walking their dog. You know, it's just, I don't know. And out in nature, I don't know. It's... Where can I walk? Some people walk in the mall. I don't want to do that. Walk on the beach. That kind of strains the knee also. The sand, it's not the same. Where can I just take a nice walk? I don't know. I have to ask the Holy Spirit. Wow. You know, wow, where can I walk? Wow. Wow, my knee's hurting. Wow. My knee is wowish. You can do that. My knee. How's your knee? Well, it's wowish. It's wow is what it is. How much wow? Wow much wow. Okay? It's wow much wow. See, no analysis. No analysis. Now, when I accepted what God wants me to do, my knee got better. It was like almost instantaneous. It was just like suddenly my knee felt well. So maybe I'm a little bit off track here in what I was trying to do. I'm not sure exactly what's going on here. Just have to wow it. How do you feel? Are you sure about this? I'm wow about this. Well, how wow are you about this? I'm wow about this. Isn't that beautiful? You don't go into evaluation, blocking it. That's being like extremely right-minded, extremely abstract, extremely right-minded. I had a dream quite some time ago, and I was shown the way to get free of the torment here is to be extremely, excuse me, extremely right-minded. You have to go to the farthest right-mindedness, all the way to the right-mindedness, and then you'll suddenly see, oh, there's a way, these steps you can take, and liberate it. It was a fabulous dream. I was stuck in this horrible, horrible place, super toxic place, and I was so wanting to get out of here, and I finally found the way. So this is your extreme right-mindedness to use this practice. But it's the way. It is the way. So just get the confidence. Just feel the confidence. The certainty. The certainty of it. The certainty of it. Wow. How do you feel? Well, I feel wow. Are you certain about it? I'm wow about it. Well, I thought you said you're certain. Meaning they're trying to pull you into evaluation. The mind's trying to pull you in an evaluation. You say, well, yeah, I have an evaluation already. And my evaluation is wow. And it's really our own mind that is fearful about this. So as we reassure our own mind that this, you know, this is how we're doing it, then our mind calms down more and more and more and more and more. And becomes more and more willing to experience the peace of God. So, hopefully, you had a wow time. And not even hopefully, I know you had a wow time. And not even I know you had a time, I wow that you had a wow time. And not even time, I wow that you wow. And that's wow.